Hi guys, this is Vitaly with AFT Dispatch and A2C Logistics, and in today's video, I'd like to speak with you about electric truck infrastructure and what it will take to get these trucks on a road and actually start to replace the diesel trucks that are on the road today. But first, roll the intro. Welcome back. Before we get started, I'd like to ask you to please like the video, be sure you subscribe to the channel, and hit the notification bell so you never miss a single release of our videos, where every Friday we're talking about something that could benefit you in your trucking businesses, in your trucking careers, as well as cover the loads we've successfully booked for our customers, consisting of leased on owner operators and carriers operating under their own MC authorities, running under our truck dispatch services. As always, guys, big thank you for all the likes you've provided in all the previous videos. Please do keep them coming, and let's talk truck electrification. You know, electric trucks really shouldn't be a concern to most truckers of modern day with the diesel combustion engines. I know that's been talk of the town. It's all over the news, and we've actually made several videos. I'll leave a little cards here in the corner so you guys can take a look at that. But ultimately, there are several problems. One of those is that the electric grid, the American electric grid, needs some enormous changes. The needs are enormous in the first place if we're planning on doing anything with these electric semi-trucks. Now, what we're talking about here, and pay attention, you know, up to 40% of all electricity in the nation would actually be needed for battery-powered cars and trucks. So we're lumping those together. Cars and trucks together would need up to 40% of all the electricity generated today to actually run these vehicles. Now, when it comes to long-haul trucks, we're talking 10% usage for the total if we were to actually move forward with electrification. Now, if we break these numbers down, this is what it looks like. 26.3% of passenger cars and trucks, that would be 26.3% of electricity of that total 40% would go towards that. 14% would be all the freight trucks that are out there. And out of those, 10.6% would be the long haul trucks, the OTR guys such as yourselves. And in total, we're looking at 40.3% for all vehicles. So an absolutely astonishing number that would have to be reached in order for electrification to become an actual viable option in the market today. Now, some states would actually need more than 50% of their current electricity generation, so they would have to increase a considerable amount. And some states would actually need 60% more energy production. Like, for example, I'm currently in Lincoln, Nebraska. Those numbers are around the 40%. But in Utah, where I came from, we'd have over 60% need. So it's one of those states with the deeper colors in some of the graphics that I was looking at, which basically would require considerable investment into additional energy production for those specific states. Some states are more, some states are less. Now, very large infrastructure investments would have to be put in place throughout the next several decades in order for us to be able to reach this issue. That's why I say this is not a big deal for your regular diesel trucks. Ultimately, we would be draining global reserves of different types of materials, minerals, basically raw materials to produce these batteries. We're talking cobalt, graphite, lithium, and of course nickel. So all of these items are needed in order to produce these electric batteries, and we're already draining global reserves. So we're talking about further draining of global reserves of these types of raw materials. Now, at current production levels, it would actually take somewhere between 6.3 to all the way to 34.9 years to meet the demand. So anywhere from 6 to 35 years in order to simply meet the demands that are necessary in order to make this thing a viable option, which would be equal to 8.4% to all the way up to 64.4% of the global reserves for just the U.S. vehicle fleet alone. So we're not even talking global, just in the United States alone. And we'd need more chargers than there actually are any parking spots for trucks in the United States. And we know that parking or truck parking in the U.S. is a big issue and something that's always discussed, and we're always requesting more and more money to be invested into truck parking. So to kind of clear that up, we'd actually need more chargers to get these vehicles on the road and keep them on the road than the amount of parking spots that we have available for semi-trucks today. Now, chargers, here's the cost breakdown. Each charger for the semi-trucks would be $112,000 for each charger. So that's a $35 billion investment for a nationwide system. And so now we're talking very, very big numbers. Ultimately, You know, we'd be looking at utilities, the biggest issues, you know, truck parking facilities, and finally the vehicle production supply chain would actually have to get ramped up in order, because we need the electricity, we need all the raw materials, we need the locations where trucks could park and actually charge. We need the chargers, and we need the supply chain to get ramped up in order to actually start producing the vehicles that would have a hard time charging as of today, as of the recording of this video. So a lot has to happen. And ultimately, there are different manufacturers, truck manufacturers that are jumping in. I mean, all the major guys are working on electrification and different types of fuel cell technology. So in this case, well, let's cover Cummins, because they're the ones who are actually working on several different modes of transportation for the semi-truck world. We're talking hydrogen, natural gas, propane, and even gasoline truck engines to pull heavy freight, 80,000-pound GVW trucks. Right now, they're looking at a 15-liter natural gas truck, so a 15-liter motor that would be produced in 2024, and that's actually getting them very similar performance to what they're seeing in diesel-powered semi-trucks. And then in 2027, they're expecting a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle to go live. So we'll have to cross that bridge when we get there. But ultimately, I'd like to know, what are your thoughts? You know, take a look at our previous videos. Those generated quite a bit of views and lots of interesting comments, and it was definitely interesting videos to watch. So I'll leave those cards throughout the corner of this video so you can click on those and take a look, kind of, you know, feel things out. But are you concerned as an OTR truck driver, as a professional CDL truck driver, are you concerned about these electric semi-trucks, electrification of our nation? And do you think this is even doable or not? So would love to, you know, hear your comments in a comment section below. By the way, this has been a fantastic week in trucking. Make sure to watch this video all the way through, because I'm going to switch over. We're going to look over the loads that we book for our customers. And there is still money in trucking, guys. You will see in the next portion that all of our top averages, all the loads that we're going to present you for the average in the week, were all over $3 a mile. So definitely watch the remainder of this video. Make sure you hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell. I'm going to switch over to camera, and I'll see you guys in just a moment. Welcome back. Let's take a look at some of these loads. Guys, as mentioned at the beginning of the video, every single one of our top paying loads carriers this week were averaged over $3 a mile on their miles. And we haven't seen something like this in a long, long time. So stick around to the very end of this video. Definitely something worth watching. Going to start off with a reefer coming out of Franklin Park, Illinois, going to Four Oaks, North Carolina. It's a 25,000-pound load of COVID test kits, running 68 degrees on a reefer. 852 miles booked at $3,400, got them $3.99 a mile. Then Greensboro, North Carolina, to Cloquet, Minnesota, with a 24,000-pound load of tanker, endorsed load, 33 to 60 degrees on a reefer, very light load of 24,000 pounds, 1,217 miles booked at $3,000, got them $2.47 a mile. They finished off with Eagan, Minnesota, going to Pittston, Pennsylvania, another light load of 32,000 pounds of tortillas, 35 to 55 degrees on a reefer, 1,102 miles booked at $36.25, got them $3.29 per mile. Their solo reefer spent 7 days on the road, Friday to Friday, and grossed an amazing $10,025 for the week as a solo driver, running 3,171 loaded miles at an average of 3.16 per loaded mile average. Excellent, excellent job. Next, we got ourselves a dry van, different setup, doing some short runs on this. Equally as impressive. Starting out of Rochelle, Illinois, going to Oconomowoc, Wisconsin, with a 37,000-pound load of pasta, 107-mile run, $800 booked, got him an easy $7.48 a mile. Then Watertown, Wisconsin, to Auburn, Indiana, it's a 37,000-pound load of food ingredients, 322 miles booked at $1,100, got him $3.42 a mile. Then Fort Wayne, Indiana, going to Brighton, Michigan, with a 40,000-pound load of dry groceries, 173 miles booked at $700, got him $4.05 a mile. Then Kendallville, Indiana, to Normal, Illinois, with a 25,000-pound load of FAK, 267 miles booked at $12.50, got him $4.68 a mile. Then looks like Streeter, Illinois, to La Crosse, Wisconsin, with a 37,000-pound load of beverages, 299 miles booked at $1,200, got him $4.01 per mile. Then Sparta, Wisconsin, going to Holland, Michigan. This is a very light load of 5,000 pounds of over-the-counter pharmaceutical products, 409 miles booked at $1,100, got them an easy $2.69 a mile. Then Zero Deadhead coming out of Holland, Michigan, to Mount Vernon, Illinois, 9,000-pound load of health products, 394 miles booked at $1,150, got them $2.92 a mile. And it finished off with Centralia, Illinois, going to Danville, Illinois, real quick run. Also light load of 9,000 pounds of packaging materials, 173 miles, booked at $600, got him $347 a mile. That was it. Solo dry van coming out for a week on road, Friday to Friday, grossed $7,900 for the week, ran 2,144 loaded miles at an average of 368 per loaded mile average. Excellent, excellent job. Now, the next one's really interesting. It was a reefer coming out of Bolingbrook, Illinois, with one pick, two dropper in Manassas, Virginia, and a final in Richmond, Virginia. It's a 42,000-pound load of frozen bread, running negative 10 on a reefer, 818 miles, booked at $3,300, got him $403 a mile. The next load was supposed to come out of Portsmouth, Virginia, going to Harrisonville, Missouri. Unfortunately, that was canceled. We ended up collecting $150 tonneau. Truck order not used, and they picked up their next load out of Williamsburg, Virginia to South Charleston, West Virginia. It's a heavier load. It's a load-to-scale load of beer, 371 miles, booked at $1,200, got them $323 a mile. They finished off of Columbus, Ohio to Jacksonville, Florida. It's a 40,000-pound load of medical materials and equipment, running 65 degrees on a reefer. It's an 806-mile run, booked at $3,200, got them $397 a mile going out to Jacksonville. Excellent job, week on a road, ended up grossing $7,850 on their week, ran 1,995 loaded miles at an average of 393 per loaded mile average. Excellent, excellent job. Next, we got ourselves another reefer coming out of No-Show, Missouri, with a one-pick four-dropper to Helena, Montana, Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, Spokane Valley, Washington, and a final in Kent, Washington. A very light load of 15,000 pounds of furniture. I'm sure the reefer stayed off on that one. 2,009 miles, booked at $6,700, got him $333 a mile. Excellent jump coming out of Missouri, going out to the West Coast. Excellent rate. Then the last load they took was out of Kent, Washington, so zero deadhead there. Went out to Ronan, Montana. Another light load of 16,000 pounds of groceries, 470 miles, booked at $1,800, got him $383 a mile. And that was it for the week. They ran for 7 days, got their 34-hour reset included over the weekend, ended up grossing $8,500 on a dot, ran 2,479 loaded miles at an average of 343 per loaded mile average. Excellent, excellent job. Next, we got ourselves another dry van coming out of Spring Hill, Tennessee, going to Burton, Michigan, with a 35,000-pound load of auto parts, 615 miles, booked at $1,400, got him $228 a mile. Then Whitmore Lake, Michigan, to Windham, Minnesota, with a 22,000-pound load of different assortment products, 760 miles, booked at $1,720, got him $226 a mile. Then Estherville, Iowa, going to McCook, Nebraska, with a 29,000-pound load of parts, 459 miles, booked at $1,850, got him a great rate of $403 a mile. Then North Platte, Nebraska to Littleton, Colorado, with a 40,000-pound load of consumer goods. We're talking 273 miles, booked at $1,300, got him $476 a mile. And they finished off their week with Commerce City, Colorado, going to Billings, Montana, with a 17,000-pound load of domestic kitchen appliances. 550 miles, booked at $1,780, got them $324 a mile, going out to Montana. Now, they spent a week on a road. This is a solo drive-in. Got their 34-hour reset included over the weekend. Ran 2,657 loaded miles at an average of $303 a mile, which grossed them just over $8,000 at $8,050 for the week. Next, we got ourselves a reefer coming out of Edgerton, Kansas to Omaha, Nebraska. 44,000-pound load of food and beverages. This is a dry load. The reefer stayed off on it. 216 miles, booked at $880, got him $407 a mile. Then Lincoln, Nebraska to Newport, Michigan. It's looks like a 43,000-pound load of pork running 26 degrees on a reefer. 786 miles, booked at $2,800, got him $356 a mile. Then Toledo, Ohio to Cobleskill, New York. This is a 33,000-pound load of hard seltzer. So reefer stayed off on this one as well. 556 miles booked at $1,825, got him $328 a mile. And then Schenectady, New York to Bolingbrook, Illinois, with a 42,000-pound load of miscellaneous products running 50 to 83 degrees on a reefer. 820 miles booked at $1,750, got him $213 a mile. And they finished off with DeKalb, Illinois, going to Cedar Falls, Iowa, with a 36,000-pound load of candy, 57 to 61 degrees on a reefer, 246 miles booked at $1,000, got him $407 a mile. So excellent job, week on a road there. Gross 82.55 on their 2,624 loaded miles at an average of 315 per loaded mile. Excellent job. And we're going to move on to our dry van out of Fort Wayne, Indiana, going to East St. Louis, Illinois. 41,000-pound load of cleaning compounds, 369 miles booked at $1,000 even, got them $271 a mile. Then St. Charles, Missouri, going out to New Hope, Minnesota, and a final in Friendly, Minnesota. 35,000-pound load of store fixtures, 559 miles booked at $1,500, got them $268 a mile. Then St. Paul, Minnesota to Davenport, Iowa, with a 42,000-pound load of freight of all kinds, or FAK, 315 miles booked at $1,050, got them $333 a mile. Then Muscatine, Iowa to Memphis, Tennessee with a 44,000-pound load of AG chemicals, so agricultural products, agricultural chemicals, 534 miles booked at $1,800, got them $337 a mile. And they finished off with Olive Branch, Mississippi, going to Pasadena, Texas, with a 30,000-pound load of bales, 602 miles, booked at $2,000, got them $332 a mile. Now, here's the best part, and maybe I should have put this one at the beginning. Here's the thing. They only ran for 5 days, guys, from Tuesday to Sunday. We're talking 5 days OTR, gross $7,350 in just 5 days in today's market, ran 2,379 loaded miles at an average of 309 per loaded mile average. Excellent job. And by the way, thank you for sticking through the rest of this video. We're going to finish off with our last reefer of the week, coming out of Hillsboro, Oregon to Wenatchee, Washington. This is a 35,000-pound load of food grade packaging. It's a dry load, 321 miles booked at $1,600, got them $498 a mile. Then finished off right out of Pasco, Washington, going to Jessup, Maryland. Long, long run with a 40,000-pound load of onions. It was running a protect from freeze, so nothing too crazy. Lots of miles, a 2,618 loaded miles at an average of $7,250 booked, which got them $277 a mile on a ton of miles, over 2,600 miles. That was it for their week. They ran for 7 days, a Monday to Monday, ended up grossing $8,850 in 7 days, ran 2,939 loaded miles at an average of 301 per loaded mile average. So excellent job. And as you can see, we've been doing this, you know, for some time now. And, you know, we work with carriers as well as owner operators. You can have company drivers in your fleet, or you could be the only driver. The bottom line is that we've been doing this through ups and downs of every market that we've been over the last 10 years. And our dispatchers are very, very experienced. They know what to look for. And they know, obviously, as you can see from these loads, how to position you in the right ways to be able to take advantage of the different ups and downs in the markets. And as markets cool down and heat up in different parts of the country, this is what they're doing. And as they say, you know, no replacement for displacement. Well, there's no replacement for experience either. So if you'd like to learn more, please do get in touch with us at 801-448-6363. Call or text that number. You can also go to our website at aftdispatch.com/go. Fill out the forms there if you're a carrier or an owner operator, or simply fill out any one of our chat boxes on any one of our websites or web pages. Simply put in your information in there, send it over to us. We'll call you, answer any and all your questions, and definitely, you know, don't rest on your laurels, because the money is there. There's still money in trucking. You're able to make it. Things are not as bad as, you know, they try to tell us. So there is a way to make money in the industry. But guys, until next week, stay healthy, be wealthy. Take care.